The book is called Remembered Forever, and of course they will be. They will be. I'm so sorry. It's just the most awfulest thing to have happened. I can't imagine how you're dealing with it, but you're dealing with it so, so well.
Yeah, well, I think for us, the hardest bit is finding new purpose in our lives.
Right.
And the book and us speaking out and sharing our story and helping other people is what helps us kind of get through each day, I think, and helps us look to the future.
So when you were growing up in this house, was he a violent man or was it more about control?
So our father was very, very coercive and controlling.
Right.
And he wasn't violent. And in fact, he didn't need to be because financially he'd trapped our mother. He'd isolated her by taking away from work and friends. And he found all the ways to make life really hard without creating incidents that would lead someone to call the police or a neighbour to intervene.
Right.
And we just thought our life was hard because our father was attributing accountability elsewhere.
Yeah.
It was never him who was responsible. Mm. So we never really understood what was going on. And when the murders happened, we were shocked because they seemed to have come out of nowhere. The violence seemed to come at once. But it was only when we looked back over our lives that we realised he'd been incredibly controlling and actually he'd ramped it up significantly leading up to the murders.
So your mum eventually wanted to leave. I mean, she wanted to get out of that situation. Mm. Your sister, you say that your sister was braver than you. She would stand up to him.
Mm. Yeah, I think Luke and I, growing up in that environment, I think I learnt to kind of submit to his rules and demands because it seemed safer.
Understand.
And I think over those 25 years of that abuse, I didn't know how to respond in a way which kept Mum and Charlotte safe. Especially because I was going away to university and to work. But yeah, Charlotte was always the one out of the whole family who stood up and she knew what was right. And I think our father was scared of Charlotte.
Really?
And we definitely admired Charlotte a lot for her strength and her bravery.
Hmm. And finally, you'd managed to get them out of the situation. Your mum was moving out completely, wasn't she?
Yeah, so our father always used to use money as a way to trap our mum. So mum suffered from multiple sclerosis and she could only work part-time. And she never could survive by herself. So when we were young, we realised that it kind of laid on us to create that future.
Okay.
So once we'd gone to work, we saved up the money and eventually we had enough to rent somewhere for Mum and Charlotte and to support them. And we managed to, when our father was away from work, we managed to get Mum out of the house and move to a new rental house. And it was only 5 days after we'd moved them out that our father then hunted them down and killed them both.
Jeez. How did you find out the news?
So I was working abroad in Holland at the time. Got back to my desk after some meetings, just checked some app on my phone for the news, and I saw the breaking news story of three dead in a shooting in Spalding. I called Luke, and then we called the local police station, and I think over the next few hours, it slowly kind of unraveled. It took me, I'd say, a month to accept it. It wasn't until the funerals that I really accepted what had happened. But that day was spent, I think, in like state of confusion, shock, anger.
Disbelief.
Yeah.
Of course. And especially as it looked like they were going to have a new life. Tell me what were they like? I mean, we talked about them a little bit, but how do you remember them the best?
So Mum and Charlotte are incredibly strong, which is part of the reason that we never thought it was domestic abuse, because you think that victims are weak and perpetrators are strong and there's that dynamic. But we always saw our father as really weak. And we saw Mum and Charlotte as incredibly strong. So it didn't seem to fit the dynamic that we'd interpreted. Mum was incredibly stoical. She was an incredible mum. She looked after us above all else and before herself as well. But Charlotte was just incredibly brave and courageous and would often call our father out for what he was doing and say it's not right. And Charlotte was Mum's emotional support as well. She in many ways, helped our mum come out of her shell.
Yeah.
They were like sisters, really. And our father hated Charlotte because he saw her as really ruining his control over our mother. He didn't like Charlotte supporting our mother, so Charlotte got the brunt of our father's behaviour.
It's an absolute nightmare. I mean, the fact that you're still, you're so articulate and so wanting to help others, that's the thing, isn't it? You don't, you want to help other people who are probably or perhaps going through the same thing.
Yeah, right. I think we recognise that our story isn't actually unique. There are a lot of threads which throughout domestic abuse cases have a lot in common. And one of those, as Luke mentioned, is about control.
Yeah.
That we were looking for violence in our father, and that violence only came on the day of the murders. So we didn't see ourselves as victims because we weren't being hit. And we want to, I think, articulate the truth that domestic abuse is about control and power, and to look out for the non-physical forms of abuse, because they are often more prevalent.
Yeah.
And quite psychologically damaging as well. Like, if I had him in hit, I would have, you know, recovered from the bruises and cuts. But the scars, like, internally, that I have to live with from the abuse of my father take much longer to get over and heal from.
No, I can understand that. Do you think it's affected your ability to form relationships with other people? I don't just mean with other women, I mean with friends, and it's a trust thing, perhaps?
I think so, but also we learned to be very self-reliant, and also we didn't want, as children, we didn't want to need stuff because there wasn't much to go around. We wanted Mum and Chart to have it, and they wanted us to have it. So we all became very self-sacrificing and very, I guess, you know, independent. Yeah. And I guess going forward, I, in particular, have been incredibly independent because I guess I don't want to feel like a burden. And also, I sometimes don't have the energy to help other people with their problems because I'm so tired. So I think it's affected them in the fact that they can sometimes, relationships can seem like a bit too much to take on, I think, from my perspective sometimes.
Yeah. That makes sense. That makes perfect sense. It really does. I know that you do speaking, you talk to organisations and you try to somehow find some sort of light in this terrible tragedy.
Yeah, so I think one of the things that we realised was after the murders, Mum always told us growing up, your freedom comes from educating yourself. So we threw ourselves into school. And after the murders, the only thing I knew to do was to read. And we read a lot of feminist stuff, we read a lot of criminology stuff, and we realised that who our father was is the archetypical domestic abuser and family murderer. But we never saw it because we were looking for violence rather than the controlling behaviours.
I understand.
And actually, everyone in our lives didn't see it because he was just controlling. They didn't see him as being abusive. And we realise there's so much that we don't understand culturally about domestic abusers that is understood by feminists and those that study it. And we realise that just needs to be this transition of knowledge because domestic abuse is so incredibly common that, unfortunately, many of us live with it without even knowing that it is domestic abuse. So we're just trying to help other people see what's going on and hopefully protect themselves.